Climate change, female equality and a federal ICAC, some of the big issues to be pushed along by that incoming teal tide.
The moderate wing of the Liberal Party has been decimated by that teal tidal wave.
A teal wave washing away two ministers in Melbourne, including a man talked about as a future Prime Minister.
This federal election has been dubbed Independence Day as a wave of teal candidates picked off key seats in Liberal heartlands.
Well, that was an election for the ages. The major parties, especially the Liberal Party, underestimated the independents running in their seats. And right underneath their noses, these newbies snatched their heartland away and their donor base as well. It left them reeling and they still haven't fully recovered. So is this the new normal for this place? Or were the Teals just in the right place at the right time?
What we have achieved here is extraordinary.
Was that a moment in time, a perfect storm, do you think?
I think there's a build-up of things that led up to a moment that was the right moment. I don't think that that's the end of the moment necessarily either. I think this is still evolving. I think that the fragmentation of trust among people in leadership has been something that's been developing for a long time.
Morrison has got to go, hey, hey! Ho, ho!
What the community has said, you know, with me and I think across the board, is to say, you know, if you've got values, you need to stand for them. And that means not just saying, oh, I've got these values, but it's that means, you know, every vote, every issue, you actually come back to those values and see what you stand for.
I ran in my seat based on the politics that was evident in my seat. And I actually had a really strong three-horse race. It was a Labor candidate, a Liberal candidate, and an Independent candidate. So I didn't run to bring the Liberal Party down.
So what exactly did happen at the last election? Who were the voters who shifted so dramatically? And why? Our election analyst, Tom Connell, did a deep dive on the numbers.
Who are the Teal voters? This is done from post-election studies. Only about one in six, we believe, were Liberal voters. So that's the number the Liberal Party want to win back in terms of that primary vote. So-called switchers, the people that switch from the Liberal Party, uni degrees, professionals and women were the sorts of people that showed up the most. The rest, tactical Labor, Green or minor parties. So they voted for the Teals, wanting to vote the Liberal Party out, essentially. All of the voters voting for the Teals had priorities of climate change and also social issues. And the other big thing as well, there was a strong dislike of Scott Morrison. So when you think of the one in six, the Liberal voters, well, that's where that last factor there is a big one. This is another interesting stat as well. This is a snapshot of the voters' ideology done by the ANU in a study on the election. The red is what voters see in terms of their left-right position. So this is centre-right, if you like, and this is what they think of the coalition. So the coalition basically matches up. Labor voters think they're a bit left, and the coalition's a bit more right. Greens think they're even more left at 3, and the coalition is more right at 7.2. Why am I saying all this? Well, look at Teal. So this roughly lines up with a Labor voter in terms of their view of the world, but also thinks the coalition is further right. In other words, we're not talking about centre-right voters that are voting for the Teals. They're centre-left, if anything.
Despite the massive shift, the Teals did not snatch that ultimate prize, the balance of power. Without that stranglehold on the government, they dictate nothing. They've had to insert themselves in the national debate.
It's a difficult spot to be in, because certainly in the House, we don't have the balance of power on the crossbench.
No.
However,
did you think you were going to get the balance of power? And would that have made your life easier, do you think?
It could have made it easier, it could have made it harder.
Busier?
Yeah, well, it's pretty busy already, I've got to be honest. If we'd had the balance of power, it would have been different. We don't have the balance of power.
What we saw at the 2022 election, in fact, was that drop of the primary vote, which says Australian people are looking for alternatives. They are not just going to accept status quo if that status quo is not delivering on results.
The Teals ran on a broad platform that encompassed three main issues, and that was getting more women into parliament, greater integrity in government, and action on climate change. With a government like an Albanese government largely addressing those concerns, what's the reason to vote for you next time?
I think it's saying, well, I've delivered what I said was important. But at the same time, I hold the government to account on all their
but
policies.
But the government's delivered, right?
No, I worked with the government. Exactly. Like, you know, that's what my community asked me to make sure these things happened. They're going to come out of this election saying this has happened. You know, if they had, you know, Dave Sharma in, they wouldn't have that success there.
I actually think that people like myself were sent to Canberra off the back of the last election. Actually came from a place far deeper than any one issue. It was a very sincere sense of frustration.
At some point the electorate's going to want concrete, you know, give me a list of biggest achievements. You can't quite do that yet, can you?
Well, I think we can. I think we can see what I'm doing. I think that there's a lot of things that we've been working on and actually pushing for.
Does your relevance wane?
Well, I think that most people understand that where we are at the moment is only the very, very beginning.
We did it!
Well, many of the things that the government has on its plate at the moment are things that it has on its plate because it's been forced to give its attention to those issues.
All of us in our roles, no matter what we do, have the obligation to try to nudge things in the right direction. And you never really know if your nudge was the one that got it over the line.
Is nudging going to satisfy their electoral masters? It's still 2 years until the next federal election, but we can see that different voting trends and competing issues in different states might make it hard to both maintain this level of representation in the parliament or expand it.
So we go from the federal election in May last year. In November, a few months later, the Teals had their eyes on seats in Victoria, but they disappointed. Why? Well, let's take a look at a couple of most relevant seats. Mornington, you can see on this map, look, there's some chance the Teals on this, but that's a lower vote than they'd want, 22.4. And as well, the Liberal Party vote is not losing as much as it did at the federal election. 6%, it's in a danger zone, but at 22.4, we are going to see preferences help the Teals, but how much? So when we go to the two-party preferred on that, it's close, but Kate Lardner, because if she just boosted her vote by another percent and took that off the Liberal Party, she'd win. She didn't. Getting in the low 20s there cost her in the end. The other seat they were closest to in Victoria, Brighton, 45.6% is instantly the problem here for the Teals, first of all. It's a swing towards the Liberal Party, so we're not seeing anger towards the Liberal Party as we saw at the federal election. And then you go down here. Well, hang on, Felicity Frederica was a Teal, 9%. In other words, a total flop there for the Teal. And as you can see here, 55 compared to 45 effectively, and the Teal's not even in the contest. So they didn't pick up any seats in Victoria. How much of a factor was it the fact that it wasn't a Liberal leader, but it was Daniel Andrews, the Victorian Labor leader, who was actually the totemic figure of the election? Going to New South Wales, it's a bit more of a mixed bag. Let's have a look at Wallandilly first of all. Straight away you see, okay, this is more like a good Teal result. 34% or just below a swing against, but that clearly puts him in a danger area, 25. So a better result for the Teal. And again, they're going to go well from these preferences. Noting, optional preferential voting in New South Wales. Voters can fill out a one. They don't have to go all the way through their card and the vote can exhaust. In other words, some of these percentage points will drop off and not help out the Teal overall. And yet, Judy Hannon does just get over the line, 51.5. So Nathaniel Smith largely losing because of that quite low primary vote. So that's Wallandilly. Then we go to Pittwater. This one, again, similar. If we look at this at a federal seat, a 12% loss, dipping below 45%, an independent at 35, this is the sort of ingredient that says it'll be close. And in fact, on those numbers, if it weren't for optional preferential voting, you'd have Jackie Scrooby likely getting to about 52. With that leakage, that exhaustion of vote, she falls just short. So how much did optional preferential voting play a part? I'd say just this seat of Pittwater. There weren't any others. The Teals were this close and they could have actually won. And it's worth noting, we've shown you the best two seats. There were some they disappointed in. Helen Conway was favoured to win this seat. That's just too low a primary, really, to compete at 21.9, unless we saw a much lower primary from the Liberal Party. So that combination, 44 versus 21, adding in optional preferential voting as well, we'll just make the number bigger. That's too big a gap to bridge. And when we see that on the primary vote, put out to two-party preferred, you see Helen Conway, even though she was the favourite, and they're getting 44% two-party preferred. It did sum up the Teals. They weren't a disaster in New South Wales, but it was nowhere near the result we saw at the federal election.
3 years on, this is a win for community.
You've only really eaten into one-sided politics.
In relation to the Liberal Party, I think the question is, where has the Liberal Party gone? It has abandoned our communities when it comes to the views and values and issues our communities care about. It has gotten lazy and assumed that a attitude of give me your vote and don't worry too much about the policies over the next 3 years would be good enough. It's not.
You got the Trent Zimmerman.
No, I definitely don't think that one.
Okay. Our climate has changed.
You knocked off a future Liberal leader at the last election in Josh Frydenberg. How do you reflect on that?
The premise of that question is fundamentally flawed, because what happened actually is that the people of Kuyong decided that their previous representative no longer represented them in the way that they wanted.
The party or the individual, do you think?
Well, you'd have to ask the people of Kuyong, but they were very, very clear about what they wanted. They didn't want someone who was a career politician who was essentially in it to lead the Liberal Party. They wanted someone who came from the community to represent the community. And that's the decision that they made.
A byproduct of your rise and the rise of the other Teals has been to kill the Liberal Party in many ways. Their base, their opposition, you can see it in the House. How do you mind that's what you've done?
Again, I think the language that you're using there is a bit problematic. I'm not going to use the K-word. You know, I haven't done anything. My community has spoken for who it wants, and it's chosen a representative that represents their values and what they want from their individual representative.
Well, the Liberal Party was not representing the values of the people in my electorate, and I don't think that keeping an existing structure for the sake of it is right. I think that democracy can actually deliver different and new outcomes.
They pool resources, they align on policy, and even present a united front to the media. So are they as fiercely independent as they say, or are they a quasi-minor party?
High deficits going out, as far as the eye can see, when we've got, you know, a significant, $1 trillion worth of debt, every dollar counts, and it should count.
Are you strength in numbers? I mean, you're not a party, you don't want to call yourself a party, and whenever I suggest that it, you know, looks and sounds like a party, none of the independents like that at all. Why not?
Well, the reality is, we're not a party. If you watch us, even just today, the divisions that we had today, we went in different directions and we spoke in different ways about different issues. We're actually quite disparate. The strength of the crossbench is in its increasing numbers. There's no doubt about that.
Well, at this point in time, it's not what my community asked of me.
Yeah, but, why not? Is that on the cards? Could you become a party? We have different spokespeople within the movement for different portfolios. You agree on things?
I don't know. What I do know is that I think the next decade in politics in Australia is going to be incredibly interesting.
We work well together. Now, the media can't have it both ways. On one hand, have an outcry about independents being elected and say it's going to be chaos, everyone's going to be doing their own thing. But then on the other hand, say if we work well together in a constructive, efficient way, that is a negative as well.
We have a lot of things in common, and some of that is values and a desire for long-term thinking, compassion, a sense of fairness. And I really like the rest of the crossbench who I've met. But ultimately, we are all accountable to our own communities. And that's really what is at the core of this movement.
No two elections are the same. And 2025 is going to be a vastly different landscape for all the reasons we've explained. We haven't even got to the change in donation laws, the fact that Teals will have a record they'll need to defend. There's no Morrison factor, and all of their seats are marginal.
There's one big factor why the Teals were less of a factor in those New South Wales and Victorian elections. It's all about donations laws, how much people can contribute to their campaigns and how much they're hobbled. New South Wales, individual cap is $3,300. Total amount any campaign can actually raise, $198,000, much less than they spent federally on all of the Teal campaigns. Victoria is similar, $4,300. Now, the total is unlimited, But the limit on individuals, again, means some of those big donors we saw come through for the Teals federally and giving maybe $100,000, $200,000, they cannot donate. They're capped at $4,300. Federally, it's totally unlimited. We saw some huge war chests compiled by Teal candidates outspending their Liberal rivals. They can do that again next time around. They couldn't do that in New South Wales and Victoria. The question is, though, will that happen next time around? For a few reasons. There's no Morrison this time, or no coalition government. That was a huge part of their campaign. It was all about being against Scott Morrison. They won't have that this time around, that touchstone, if you like. Raising money and getting volunteers as a result might be more difficult. It's usually easier to turn people out, to turf someone out, rather than keep the status quo. So will they still be able to outspend their Liberal counterparts there? And is this a political movement or another so-called party? This goes to the political debate in a big way. The Liberal Party want to say the Teals are a party. They're just not saying they are. The Teals want to say they're grassroots, they're a movement, and they will stay strong. And then we get to the big factor, the post-material vote, if you like. People in 2022 at that election never been better off in these Teal seats. They had money sitting in the bank because of COVID payments. Where are they now? The COVID cash is gone. The rate rises are here. Will they head back to economic issues they vote on rather than some of the social issues? And when we look at this as well, what are the margins to defend? Warringah 11% looks relatively safe, but you'd think a better Liberal candidate could make a difference. Beyond that, none of these margins scream safe. 4.2% is not bad, and you do have a Teal candidate there that's, well, had some success in terms of independence in that seat before. You get to the rest, 2.9% and lower. In other words, these are not big margins. Small changes to the primary vote on the Teal and Liberal side could see these seats flip back quite easily.
Do you think your constituents are comfortable with the Simon Holmes Accord link? Is it a problem? Does it sit well with you? Are you beholden to, you say you're beholden to no one, but is there an expectation from him?
I'm beholden to every one of my constituents. I had many, many donors in the 2022 election.
Do they influence you in any way?
I talk to everyone who wants to come and talk to me, essentially. I don't owe anyone anything, and there's certainly no debt at all. But if people want to talk to me about what matters to them, which might be the closure of a post office, or it might be a rule of change around prescriptions, or it might be something specific about climate, it's my duty as the representative for Kooyong to talk to those people.
The Australian public's going, why would Simon Holmes a court put all his cash and donate to the Teals individually if he doesn't want something in return? What do you say to that? Do you think people are asking themselves that question, or am I too cynical?
When you look, I think where there is confusion, or there, and a lot of it is created by party PR machinery, is I didn't take money from Simon Holmes Accord personally. I didn't even meet Simon Holmes Accord until I'd been announced as Simon Holmes Accord didn't give me money. I didn't accept
Did
a donation.
Did he give you campaign money?
I didn't accept any money from Simon Holmes Accord as an individual.
So
there was an entity, a body set up called Climate 200,
right,
which then collected donations from thousands of Australians.
Yeah.
And then that entity, based on the charter it had set for itself,
it's a bit cloudy,
gave
though.
Donations to individuals. There's greater transparency about who gave to Climate 200 and the amounts they gave than you're going to find on either of the records for the Labor or the Liberal Party in terms of their big donors.
But there's a bit of an ick factor. You know, Simon Holmes Accord, he promotes Climate 200. He can do whatever he wants. Good on him. He's privately wealthy. He can put his money wherever he likes, because that's what's so good about our democracy. But it comes back to the vibe of the thing and vested interests. Part of your political success is that you've projected this image that you're beholden to no one, except for your electorates.
I'm a 45-year-old woman. I don't need to be told what to do by a man. Thank you very much.
No, but it's about money, right?
No, sure. Yeah. And so, you know, I come back to, you know, we had hundreds of donations across the board, you know, a huge amount from Wentworth and majority from Wentworth, a bunch from Climate 200. of which a lot of those are also from Wentworth. And so, you know, I would say, you know, I'm really clear on what I stood for, and I always say to the community, you know, come back to what I've stood for, what your values are, and whether I'm delivering on those values.
In 2022, the economy was awash with COVID cash. Now that cash has delivered us a high inflation environment. Life is expensive and getting even more expensive. When you can't afford to pay your mortgage, issues like climate change tend to drop down the priority list. As Tom Connell explains, we may have already seen a slight shift away from the teals.
Let's drill right down to one particular area of one particular teal seat, federal and state, and compare what was happening, the federal election and the New South Wales state election. So this is North Sydney. These are booths out of Hunters Hill. 56-44 is how they went to the Liberal Party. That might look good on the surface, but that's well done on their, well down on their normal sort of support, which would be approaching 65-70%. So it was 56-44 in that May federal election, the next year at the state election, 62-38. In other words, support is going back towards the Liberal Party. Why have I picked this particular area? This is the sort of area the Liberal Party was losing voters on, and so why? What's changed in that time? We're talking about voters in Hunters Hill who are professionals and managers, 63% versus 37%. Household income, $3,000 versus $1,700. That's per week, but look at mortgage payments. $4,000 a month versus $1,800 a month, way above in terms of that mortgage. And this last figure there, those paying more than 30% of their income on their mortgage, this is a very rough measure of mortgage stress, 22% versus 14%. Now, not only is that a lot higher, these are figures from the census that came in before any rate rises. In other words, all of these voters, if you look at these numbers, this type of voter in Hunters Hill, and this is replicated in plenty of booths around teal seats around the country, they were very well off and feeling comfortable at the 2022 election, given all that COVID cash. Now they've had rate rises, more and more will be feeling some form of mortgage stress, and they'll be more likely to vote along their hip pocket lines rather than along social issue lines.
Could you ever see yourself going back to the Liberal Party?
I think the Liberal Party is a long way from where Wentworth is and really where I am.
Are you being encouraged to go back to the Liberal Party? I mean, it's your brother that has funded the Hilmer Network.
Yeah.
Hasn't he? So yeah. How does that all work?
Alex is trying to get more women in the Liberal Party, and I want more women in politics. In general, it is better for our country, so I support my brother on that. We don't agree on all things, but family comes first.
I guess day to day I'm asking you, why shouldn't the rest of Australia just see you and the other independents as representatives of the richest electorates in the country and the richest people?
Look, interestingly, like I have a very diverse electorate. So I think to just identify, there are parts that are very wealthy, but there are also parts of my electorate that are doing it extremely tough.
You're beholden to people doing it pretty well, the wealth creators in the country. So does that kind of skew how you vote on certain policies, and how does that affect the rest of the country?
Well, first of all, I don't think I'm beholden to anyone. I have a responsibility to my electorate, but I don't owe anything to anybody, really, other than to do my best and to deliver as well as I can on the things that I said I was going to try to achieve when I was elected.
What is clear? There is no such thing as a safe seat in Australia anymore. And that is as true for the Teals as it is any independent or MP in a major or minor party. The Teals' ability to speak directly to their electorate without the constraints and structure of a major party is a massive benefit so far. How they rebrand, though, to talk about hip pocket and economic issues will be the real test. And if you ask them who they are...
It's about being a community independent.
As a community independent, a community independent.
I'm a representative.
A community representative.
They are community independents.